Right. So make yourself comfortable in the chair. As always, give yourself those few moments to settle in. Just if you can be without straining your back or your shoulders, if you can be forwards in the chair, just do that. Just to remind yourself of this feeling that when you're sitting, you can still be supported by your feet and your legs, not to the same extent as when you're standing, of course. Maybe take a couple of slow, gentle breaths if that suits you. Just letting yourself settle in and feeling your weight dropping into the chair through your hips. As your hips drop, seeming to just create a bit of space for, say, your rib cage to drop a little bit, and then that creates a bit of space for your shoulders to drop. So we get glimpses of this feeling of being supported from within our body. Just finding a position where you're more in line with the pull of gravity, so less need to strain. And then rubbing your hands together. So give yourself a little bit of extra time to, maybe a bit of extra time to warm up and to loosen up when it's chillier like this. Tapping over your face. Over your head and neck. Bouncing one shoulder and your arm. Pinch sides. And onto the upper part of your chest. Down to your belly. And finally relax. So sit back in your chair. Notice that when, as soon as you put your feet out, you can have your feet out like this, but it kind of encourages this feeling of dropping back. So even in the chair, we can begin to see how when we move change our feet, it's going to affect through the whole of your body, letting your weight drop into the chair. Shoulders dropping back a little bit. Just thinking about your breathing, and it's always good to remind ourselves every now and then of this feeling of breathing more deeply. It's not necessarily going to sort of be something that you keep to the whole time. Hands on your belly and just see if you can feel that little bit of a rise and fall underneath your belly. Remember, in the colder weather, your breathing can become more of an issue. Certainly, if people do have regular breathing problems, then of course they're going to suffer more. But just a general sense of tightening up in the body with the cold will affect everybody's breathing. But not forcing anything. I mean, this is really just a reminder. And then coming back to the upright position. This time, you may want to be further back. I'm going to stay forwards, but as I've said before, if my back started to ache, I would move further back. But again, feeling that feet and legs, back and spine, skeleton are supporting the soft tissue of your body. You may even find that your breathing kind of follows on from that a little bit, with that deeper breathing. If it doesn't, don't Don't force it. But try not to hold your belly in. Again, shoulders just dropping down. And then just slowly turning your head. Have a sense for how far you can make this movement without there's a sort of sense of gripping, tightening in your muscles. So aware of how much space there is for movement within your body. When you've got this posture, when you've got this sense of support, and that encourages a sense of releasing the big muscles of your body. Not the only thing that will cause them to tighten up, but it's significant. Same with all the movements, especially these initial movements, hands in front of your shoulders, rolling your elbows back. I would always say start off relatively small, get a measure for how far you can move. And then maybe just to working to extend it out gently. Aware that the movement itself will do a lot of that for you. And for instance, as you become aware here, what's happening in your chest, the chest expanding and contracting, and you focus more on that, that can also help to take some of the emphasis off our shoulders going forwards. This will lead to a more flowing movement because it actually allows for the movements within the body, the flow of your blood, the flow of your energy, and the various and the movement of your muscles and so on and so forth, to happen with less restriction. Hands down to your sides, rotating your arms. The more we can. In this initial section, the more we can become aware of connections here to what's happening in your chest and your upper back, then we bring them into our awareness at the start of the session, and that improves the odds that later on we're doing other exercises, the more complex exercises, we're going to be able to. How can I put it? We're going to be able to bring those factors in without too much effort. So, the analogy I sometimes draw is with cooking. Bring your hands up, the cookery books and the programs tell us that ideally what we do when we're cooking a meal is we prepare the ingredients. And once we've got the ingredients there, we can start to add them to the dish. In whatever order they're supposed to go and do whatever is necessary, rather than like chopping the onions and then quickly chopping the carrots so that they can go in or whatever. So these are the ingredients that make up the larger movement, the more complex movements. Go back the other way. Rest your hands down. Tilting forward, your weight going into your feet more. And then, as your legs get to a point where they're like springs being compressed and they push you back into your hips and your lower back, same thing, dropping down and feeling that kind of push up, directing it forwards. The downward and upward movements. The yielding to the pull of gravity and our body's response to that, which is to absorb and then to push back, is one of the principal sort of dynamic, one of the principal energetic cycles that we make use of in Tai Chi. liken it to something like being on a trampoline or a bouncy castle. You drop down and then you start to feel the push up and then you start to move. And in that moment when we feel the push up, this is where we have the opportunity to use our intent. So if I sink back into my hips here, I'm talking about a push up. I can reasonably expect this to happen. But as I start to feel that, my intent is for the weight to go forward. Similarly, in my feet. So these little sort of comma points, these little points of punctuation that we get in all the movement, really between different stages of the movement, between the expansive stage and the contracting stage, are the ones where we can bring that focused attention that we have into our intent, and we can intend the movement. If you practice this now, when you get to something like part of the wild horse's mane, for instance, it becomes a lot more useful. So sit back into your hips, turn, and then you'll just find yourself starting to go forwards towards one leg. And we're practicing not just this movement, but this way of moving. Turn the other way. And then swing it around. Be aware of the way your spine is moving. Fluid, almost, I'm using the image before, like a plant in water. But be aware that if you go right out here, then that is lost because necessarily certain muscles and parts of your body are going to tighten up. So imagine a circle inside a square. Your feet and your hips are at the corners of the square. And the circle just touches each side of the square. And you might find, and this won't happen every time, but if you want to go a little bit further, so for instance, I go over to this side and I think, well, I'll do going a bit further. If I do this, I tighten up again. I can soften a little bit more in my hips. Now I can go out here and I've still got the stable base. So we're very careful about how we extend our range of movement. We try and do it through this releasing, softening quality rather than by straining. Changing direction. Come back to the center. Step out with one foot, put your heel down, lower your toes, see if you can apply just a little bit of pressure downwards and back. You're planting the foot. Imagine planting a bulb. You position it and then carefully press in. The other side. You don't want to straighten your knee out completely. And then alternating from side to side, noticing how your body just kind of moves across a little bit to allow that to happen. Make sure you put the foot down before you try and move the other foot. And I always find that if I'm careful about the placement of this foot, I can now push down gently, and that helps to move my other foot. Come back to the original position. It's This is the seated equivalent of what we call the Wuji position in Tai Chi, symbolized by the mountain. When we know when we do embrace Tiger, return to mountain at the end. This is what we look to come back to, this feeling of being settled in mind and body, also that stronger feeling. But another image that some of the Eastern meditative traditions have is that these image of a watchtower, that overlooks the landscape. I think of something like, think of a, in our country, we have Coast Guard posts, say up on the cliff or something like that, and whoever's sitting in there, they look out over the sea, they're looking at the whole vista. So a part of your attention is always here and always observing. Other parts of your attention are more involved. We use our intention to create shapes and so on and so forth. But just cultivating the sense, the stillness at the heart of the movement, not just a, not, not a sleepy stillness, not an absence of something, but a stillness that enables that process of observation. So now, bird folds its wings, moving your weight forwards, rotating your arms, sinking down and pushing back. So as you're doing an exercise like this, obviously a fair bit of your conscious intention and your conscious attention is on the actual exercise. Your weight moving, your arms rotating, maybe aware of that movement that I noted before in chest and upper back and so on and so forth. Where the sensations in your fingers, the shape that you want the fingers to create, and stuff. Yeah, just whatever details of the exercise are useful to you and that you can recall. But there's still a part of your attention that's maintains that overview of what's happening. The overview of what's happening both inside and outside, but not directly engaging with it. Fisherman cast a net. The first few exercises here are relatively simple. Doesn't mean they're easy, but they're very straightforward exercises, and that's quite deliberate so that we get an opportunity to start to bring in those various ingredients that I talked about. The ability to observe, and through that observation, to note what might be going on in the body, what's useful, what isn't useful. But also an awareness of, where do you feel the movement within the body? Where do you feel the expansion, the contraction? And yes, at the same time, another part of your attention is aware of the sort of expansive element. If you were casting the net, there would be quite a dynamic feel here. Imagine rolling a carpet out from the floor or something. You may just become aware of areas that feel a bit stiff or blocked, tight, and we just begin to bring about maybe changes, if maybe you think, oh, I don't, maybe I need to move my feet. We already noted the significance of the feet, or maybe adjust the movement slightly and so on and so forth. And sometimes just bringing our attention to that part of the body with the intention that it will start to release works as well. And then rolling the ball. So the very fact that we're familiar with these exercises gives us an opportunity to just assess, if you like, think of it like that. Trouble is, it can also just cause us to do times. I mean, we know this one, do it lots of times. I'm doing this. You start to think about, are you going to do this afternoon, or are you going to go shopping, or are you going to stay indoors and read, or I mean, just all sorts of things get in the way. And when again, when you notice that, when you observe that, just bring your attention back into the movement. Notice if there's a change in how the movement feels. So when that quality of movement is lost, it's like a little kind of voice in the back of your head saying something's wrong. Same kind of voice we might get if, say, we're walking along the road and the shoelace comes loose or something like that. And then pigeon spreads its wings. Wait, back more in your hips here, and forwards towards your feet here. Now disappear. So my fingertips were disappearing from the screen. That's better. The soft massaging quality of movement, particularly in chest and upper back. So if you are somebody who feels that the cold is kind of causing you to constrict, especially in your chest, this is a good exercise to remember. You might even want to try, as you come back and as your arms go out, taking a breath in, just see how it feels. You're not stuck in doing that. You don't have to make it last for the whole time of this particular stage of the exercise. And then this time, keep leaving your hands in front of your hip, elbows still going out a little bit, push and wave. A stronger feeling, your weight is a significant part of that. So weight is going forwards, your pelvis is tilting, your shoulder goes forwards, your shoulder pushes on your elbow, and then reversing that when you come back. That's a very straightforward line almost through your body. But then from the front, and I'm going to exaggerate. The elbows go out. They don't go behind the body, they go out. And again, that we get that opening across the chest, which as we go forwards, contract, see how it brings my elbows in, and that helps to create the shape that the hands make. To the side. There. You see where my elbow is? I don't want it right back there. Because here there's a very real physical connection. That push can come down through there. When it's here, I go forward. I can't push on the arm. I have to somehow bring the arm through. Mostly, our hands will stay and our arms will stay in that sort of position. They won't go back any further. There's some exceptions. Fisherman cast a net is one of them, of course, where we're actively pulling on the arms. But with fishermen cast a net, our hands are hanging down. So if I try to sort of do this and pull like that, it would be quite uncomfortable and tight in my back. And then punch with both fists. Here, a lot of the movement backwards is absorbed in your arm. Like if you were to, this was a spring, and you were to push on the spring, it would get tighter and tighter and more compressed. So, one of the things that's happening here, remember, we're sinking down in the hips. We feel the push from the hips that projects the arm forwards, and then finally, there's the release of the spring. But quite a strong movement, this. Don't clench your fingers tight. You should be able to get a finger down the middle of the fist. course, we do it with both hands. I can only do it with one hand when I turn around like that. Feel the muscles in your arm winding around in the spiral and releasing from the spiral. You may well find that in, I'll just point out there's the spiral there. Once that idea is kind of implanted in your attention, you may well notice other movements that share characteristics with this one. Open your fingers. Here, for instance, again, there's another spiraling. I often find that if something's pointed out to me, some kind of inner dynamic in one particular exercise, doesn't usually take long before I'm finding it everywhere. That can be a bit annoying because the fullness of your attention almost becomes a bit obsessive. My experience that passes fairly quickly, but it's like, it's that again. Oh, it's there too. Oh, it's there. Oh, it's there too, sort of thing. Turn your hands palm down, polishing the table. Now, here you are for quite a lot of the time, pulling on your arm, but they're in front of the body. Careful not to overextend your arm. One more time. Turn your hands palm up. Now we do go to the vertical movements. Is that push down and then push down through your hips? I mean, that pushes your head up. In an exaggerated sense, I push down, my head goes up. It lengthens my spine and that draws my hands up. I turn my hands over, sink down. I'm really exaggerating, I put my back out of line, but that happens and then the arms go down. So we can do this as a count. One is that push downwards. Two is the lengthening through my back, shall we say. Three is the arms following, coming into position. And one, that dropping down. Shoulders dropping, two, the hands come down, ready for the next cycle. One, two, three, one, and two. A change to the wild goose. Here we get a little bit more sideways expansion. Quite often, when we start an exercise, maybe one we're familiar with, maybe a new one, it's that there's a lot of emphasis on what our arms are doing, but that gives us the sort of clue to what's going on within the body. So we want to learn to switch our primary intention to within the body, into producing the movement. In this case, feeling the expansion through your belly and into your solar plexus, pushing your elbows out. Again, that's exaggerated, but sometimes it can be quite useful to make bigger movements than the exercise requires. I've talked about pushing hips and feet down, but if you imagine there's a ball here inside your body, in your abdomen, in your belly, then the weight of your upper body presses down on the ball, which then expands both downwards and upwards. And when we come to part in the crowd, you go forward, they sort of lean along the ball, which is compressed and expands. So that it's a way of perhaps visualizing that process of compression and expansion that I drew your attention to in your legs in particular, to a certain extent in your back. The image of the ball may help with all of that. Again, remember those punctuation points. It's that moment of settling in here, feeling the pushback in whatever form you use to create the impression and for your intent. Now let your hands drop down and dragon plucks the stars from the sky. So as we approach the lower position, that comma, because the weight of our head pushing down through the spine, the weight of our arms pulling our shoulders down towards the center. And then again, feeling the body's response, that expansion beginning. One more time. Bringing both hands in, two-way push. And slightly in front of your body, both with the upward movement and with the sideways movement. Feeling that effect, particularly in your back, I think. Notice it. Almost like somebody's gently massaging your back, lengthways and then sideways in an alternating pattern. Around. Now, as we've discovered earlier, the position of our feet influences the whole of our body. And now, put one foot out just on the heel. You may find that you're sort of able to comfortably get a slight backward angle, going into scooping the seat and looking at the sky. Let me show you what I mean from the side here. And I go back. This is the upright position here, but I may just choose to go back. I let my hips sink down. Yeah. Now, this is quite a strong position in your back, and you're going to need to contract here in your belly to start to draw yourself forwards. So, here is fine. We can still feel the movement in our back. We can feel the movement in pelvis and so on and so forth. As soon as we go back here, if there is that sense of a strain, then either don't do it, or perhaps more to the point, do it just a little, just do it just a few times, and just gradually build it up. All your fingers in, grasping the tiger's ears. Once again, the dynamic that we're looking for is made very explicit with the movements of our arms. Here, just angling forwards and out of the building, upwards. One more time. Change sides. Scooping the sea, looking at the sky. The only you do that slight movement further back, if you're comfortable with this, remember to sink your hips in when you do this. If you're going to do that, well, you do it anyway. Grasping the tiger's ears. Bring the foot back and part the wild horse's mane, weight back in your right hip, settle in. This is where we return. Forwards into your left leg, again, settle in, return and back. That's particularly important. Now going across into your left, it's particularly important if you're not sure is it, you know, what's going to happen next. From that position of observation, that we can more likely begin to see that clear way forward. This is an outcome of that lovely idea of seeking the stillness within the movement. This time, settle into your right hip, step forward with your left. And back. Step forward with the right. Remember, you plant the foot. You'll be almost certainly, I would have thought, with this one, taking a slightly more forward step, so you won't be angling out quite so much in this stage of the movement. Remember, comma in the flow, in the sentence. Each time your weight arrived in a hip or a foot, good. And just come back to this position and give yourself a few moments to reflect on some of the characteristics, not so much the physical structure, but how does it feel? Your belly, your chest, how does your breathing feel? How do your shoulders feel? Can you get that sense of being settled and calmer in your mind? These are things, or some of the things, that we will look for in the standing version of this posture. Now, rubbing your hands together, take the glasses off again. Rubbing your hands together and tapping over your face. Over your head and neck. Shoulder and arm. On the other side. Upper part of his chest. Your belly and your legs. your heels up just to get a bit of life back into the big muscles of your legs, calves and thighs. And circle them out. Back the other way, feeling the movement back into your hips. Okay, and then standing if you wish to. So, obviously, from a structural point of view, this is different to sitting down. Your legs are going to be much more engaged with the whole process. But again, think about some of those characteristics that you are able to observe. And from that position of being still, being on the mountain, being on the cliff edge, looking out over the sea, whatever image works for you, see if you can again look for some of those qualities, find some of those qualities. And you're quite experienced at this. And as that grows, we often find that there's a kind of quality of intention that goes with that awareness. That means that, and you'll often see me do it. I'm standing in front of a group and I'm there and I'm like this. And without me having to consciously think about it, my feet are sorting themselves out. I always imagine them grumbling that he's not paying attention to us, so we better sort it. So these things start to become habitual to us in this way. But we need that quality of stillness. We need that ability to observe as a kind of foundation for that to happen. And then weight forwards, hips dropping back, sinking down, and pushing up. Expanding, contracting. That same dynamic. I talked about arms being springy, your legs develop a springiness. You could still imagine the ball in the center of your body. But if that doesn't work, you could imagine straddling the ball. There's all sorts of ways we can visualize this. And rooting down, do this as a little sequence. And then wild goose. And heart in the clouds. This thing about being still, sitting still, standing still is very difficult. We can often find ourselves fidgeting around. And sometimes, I know I've done it as well. I get people to stand and their feet are constantly moving. And this is something that we begin to practice. The stillness comes from our attention focusing away through certain aspects of the nervous system. And if we practice it, those aspects of the nervous system quite simply will start to work better. This is well established in neuroscience. So if we practice being still, if we practice being calm, it's difficult. And there's no kind of ultimate goal here, I don't think. But if we pay attention to it, we will get better at it. Now let your hands drop down. Move your weight from side to side just a little bit. You might want to be in a slightly wider posture. I generally am for this. Weight moving from one leg to another, a little bit of a turn in your center. Come into your right leg, hold the ball with your right hand on top. Stand inversion of part the wild horse's mane. Settle into your left. Come back. Settle into your right. Move across, settle into your left and turn. And again, those springs within the body, given a chance just to load. And especially if you're a little bit uncertain about, where did my hand go or something like that, don't think about it. Give yourself that chance to come back to the mountain and then out again. It's just a split second, but it stops us sort of seeing the wood for the trees, as the saying goes. Or no, it's the other way around, isn't it? It stops us seeing the trees instead of the wood. But you know what I mean? You know what I mean? This was, we sometimes say we can't see the wood for the trees. It means we're so caught up in the detail that and what's on the surface that we can't get a sense for underneath. Well, I just like this quote, then. You get the idea. This time, as you come across, bring your left foot in. You can step forwards. You come back. Bring the foot back parallel. Move across. Bring the foot in. Step, plant in the foot. Settle in, take your time. Well, tricky. So, if you're finding it's not going quite right, it's not a surprise. It's often the effort that we make rather than the end result where we get the most benefit. Okay, so 1 foot forwards, checking your stance now, weight sinking down. Again, those characteristics that we found in the initial sitting can be here as well. And maybe maintained while we're moving. But chances are we will lose some of them. And I think this is true for all of us, no matter how long you've been doing this, you won't get it perfect each time. Maybe there are people out there who can, but I'm certainly not one of them. So the moment of settling our weight into each leg becomes the opportunity again to come back. Those of you familiar with these movements and these sessions, though, we always end with this embracing the tiger, coming back to the mountain. And you could say that actually what we're doing here, when we're transferring the weight, that's when we're embracing the tiger. We come back to the mountain. We embrace the tiger. We come back to the mountain. So it's never the intention that we're stuck in the mountain, that we're stuck in the watch post. It's never the case that that's all that there is. It's a balance between the two. Raising your toes and your heel. So these ideas can sound a little bit kind of esoteric, philosophical, but actually, if we practice like this in the sessions, then if we do it regularly, we gradually begin to develop these habits, bringing your foot in, stepping out, planting the foot. And you find that this quality of the stillness within the movement begins to make itself felt in your daily life as well. At first, we take a lot of time to focus on that, but it really only takes a moment once you've got a sense of what's going on. On the other side, transfer your weight, fixed step. Like a lot of things, when we start to try and do them, it can take a long time to achieve it. I always think of tying shoelaces. I can just about remember the agony of trying to tie my shoelaces, trying to learn and getting it wrong and getting frustrated, and there's a tiny tot and so on and so forth. These days, you don't have to stop and think about it, do we? It just happens. It takes almost no time at all. Raising your toes and your heel. So it's the frequency, the regularity of the practice that means that eventually these things spill over into our daily lives. Stepping in. So this thing, the exercise we did at the end, embrace tiger, return to mountain, emphasizes that. But actually, it's a process that takes place through the whole system of Tai Chi. Yang embracing the tiger is the outward going movement, if you like, are concerned with our lives, basically. Yin is the coming back to the mountain. And the whole system is a dynamic between the two. This time, step through a few times. Remember, if you are feeling a bit wobbly with this is a good way of, even if you're not actually, I think it's quite interesting to do this with a little bit of support. I'll show you how you can do that. Change direction, show you how you can do that in a moment. There's always something new to learn, even if you think you know that, oh yeah, I can do this. Yeah, I've done it loads of times. And then you do it again, and maybe you're using the chair or the wall in the way that I'll show you in a moment. Bring the feet parallel. Think, oh, never noticed that before. This often happens to me. I could do the walk in, just have my hand on the wall and have that little bit of extra support. Every now and then, something will come up. You might want to use a chair here, just doing this. And think, yeah, I know this, I can do it. Hold on. What's going on here, and so on and so forth. So it's not just about whether you feel that you need the support, using it can open up whole new areas for you. Now, right foot forwards, a few rounds of the standing version of fisherman cast the net, just to remind you what it's like to feel your arms being moved by the transfer of your weight, remembering those punctuation marks. With a lot of our attention on what our arms are doing, make sure you don't lose that. But this time, as you settle into your front leg, turn into wind blows the willows. Settle into your back leg and turn. Notice how when you turn in your hips and your waist, it moves your shoulders. The shoulders move your arms, your body expanding and contracting. And shake out. And on the other side, fisherman cast the net. Move forwards as your arms swing through and you feel the expansion in your body. Simply redirect it through the center of the body. So, a physical location for that watch point, the observation point, could be the center part of your body, moving around that. And from there, the instruction can go out. Do this, do that. This is the direction to take. This is where we're going. So now, going into dragonfly skims the water, whichever direction you want to go in, bring the other foot in. Just do this, make sure of your posture. Don't raise the leg yet. In. Are your hips and your pelvis level? And then if it's comfortable, and this is the cherry on the top of the cake, You don't have to do this if you're not comfortable with it at the moment. Bringing the foot in and then up. Aware that all the things that we're doing, the turning, the extension of the arms, the raising of your knee, the rotation in your hip, are all tricky movements. And change direction. Oops. Quite manage it then. That will happen. But we learn to recover. So when you do have these little wobbles, they're an opportunity. Because when we're embracing the tiger, sometimes it fights back. And then bring your feet parallel. Okay, go back to your chairs. That wasn't deliberate, by the way. That was a genuine wobble. I just thought I'd make the rest of it. It will happen. So when I was learning Dragonfly Skims the Water, the exercise that we've just done, I was like, oh, can't do this. It's embarrassing. And I started to look, well, why? What's going on? And that was where the support was really useful. And I discovered that if I supported myself, then I wasn't having to deal with the wobble, and I was able to, oh, right, well, I'm doing that, or whatever. And again, this is one of the things that we learn to do. We learn to observe what's going on in our movements, and to a degree to analyze it, to bring that sense of awareness and investigation, if you like to think of it like that. Oh, it's problem solving, isn't it? Why can't I do this? What's preventing that? So this idea of coming back to the mountain has many outcomes, many beneficial outcomes. The calmness, the stillness is still important. I'm not suggesting for a moment that it's not, and is a worthy end in itself. But it can also be the starting point for many other things. So let your hands drop down. Embrace tiger, return to the mountain. The main emphasis here, coming back, feeling your hips sink, your shoulders sink, your arms drawn in, and settling down, and whatever other characteristics might be useful to you. This can be a very personal observation. Yeah. My first teacher used to talk about the standing posture being one we would use in the supermarket queue. And if we want to bring this into our lives, sometimes it's useful to think, well, what would be useful to you in the supermarket queue or in the traffic jam or whatever it is? What for you is a characteristic of this process of returning? This time, just letting your hands rest. In a few moments, just sitting quietly. What are the characteristics of that quietness, that stillness? What would you associate with it? Lovely. Thank you very much, everybody, once again. Hope that was useful to you.